Here's a paradox for you. A rocket factory is more complex than a rocket, in the sense that designing a rocket factory must be strictly more difficult than designing a rocket. This is because, to design a rocket factory, you must design manufacturing robots while keeping in mind the design of the rocket. We can generalize this idea. Whenever you have a machine A building a machine B, it must be strictly more difficult to design machine A, since the design of B must already be kept in mind when designing A. Thus, machine A must be more complex than machine B.
So here's the paradox. How is it that living organisms can reproduce? If we think of living organisms as machines, then a reproducing living organism is a machine that builds itself. But a machine can't be strictly more complex than itself. This paradox may seem a bit silly at first, but if you take a moment to think about it carefully, you'll realize that resolving it isn't exactly trivial.
Here's another, more concrete version of the problem that may help you understand why this paradox is tricky. A machine building a copy of itself is akin to a computer program printing its own source code. Basically, that would make it a text file that can generate an exact copy of itself. Can you write a program that does so? In other words, can you write a program that takes no input and prints exactly the contents of the code file?
If you've done any programming, you'll realize that this is actually quite tricky. It may even seem impossible, since every time you have code that prints something, the output doesn't include the actual print keyword. You could try printing the print keyword too, but that doesn't really get you much closer. But, as you shall see, writing this sort of program, called a quine, is entirely possible, and is more than just an amusing curiosity. It turns out that the existence of self-referencing programs like quines leads to provable limitations on the capabilities of computers in general, which we will explore in this video.
Let's start by constructing a quine from scratch using a simple, made-up programming language called Sushi. To make our job easier, Sushi has a special variable called env that is assigned whenever a string appears as a line of code. For example, this code will assign the string hello world to env. Let's add a line to print env and then run the code. First, we see that the text hello world is assigned to env, then it prints the value of env to the console, so hello world without quotes. We'll also assume Sushi has a built-in string method called quoted that adds single quotes to the beginning and end of a string. For example, if we wrote print env.quoted instead and ran it, we now print the text hello world with quotes around it. Lastly, Sushi has the ability to have multiple lines of code on a single line of text, as long as they're separated by semicolons. So we could have put both lines together by separating them with a semicolon, like this. And the code will still operate in the exact same way. We'll also assume that we can print line breaks with the command print new line. All of these slightly niche features make writing a quine in Sushi a bit easier and more transparent than in a mainstream programming language. Take a moment to pause the video and give it a shot. Our solution only requires a couple lines of code.
Here's the trick that makes a quine possible. Suppose we had many lines of code and we wanted to turn this program into a quine. To print exactly that code, we'll copy the code to a new text line above it and then surround that line in quotes. That way, we're storing the resulting string into the env variable before executing the rest of the code. Then, to print this entire code file, we'd first print env.quoted, then print a new line, and then print env. This construction nearly works. But since the last three commands for printing env.quoted and then printing env aren't included in the env string, they don't appear. But that's an easy fix, just add them. Now this code file first stores this string in the env variable, then executes a bunch of potentially unrelated code, and then prints exactly its own source code. This is great because we've come up with a template for creating quines that also can execute arbitrary unrelated code.
Now, you might be complaining that writing a quine in Sushi is a lot easier than writing a quine in another language like Python or C. But writing quines in other languages is also possible using the same principles. The main difficulty that arises is the problem of printing the quotation marks around strings. Normally, in code, a string is indicated by having quotation marks around it. And when you print it, the quotation marks aren't included. But in order to print any source code exactly, you need to be able to print out the quotation marks. Sushi avoids this by using the .quoted function, which adds the quotation marks without having to write them directly into the source code. But there are similar tricks in other languages that make quines possible. Here's an example in Python that uses string formatting to achieve a similar effect, where we store a copy of the code in a variable, env, and print that variable with and without quotes. And this one in C gets around it in a different way, where the 34 is interpreted as a stand-in for quotes.
Writing a program that prints its own source code is a neat puzzle, but things only start to get really interesting when we start writing programs that utilize their own code for computation, a phenomenon known as self-reference. As an example of how this works, suppose we want to write a program that takes a single whole number k as input and outputs the kth symbol of that program's own source code. The procedure is similar to how we constructed Quines. We'll start by assuming we can do some work to store the program's source code in a variable called s instead of printing it. Then, to print the kth symbol of the source code, we just write print s bracket k. Here, we're borrowing some string notation from Python, where s bracket k means the kth symbol of the string s. To get s, we'll assume our program has two lines, the first consisting of a string containing the second line of code, which is assigned to env, and the second containing the assignment to s as well as the print s bracket k command. So, since s will store exactly the program code, s must start with env.quoted, which is the first line, then a new line, then env, which is the second line. We've borrowed some more Python notation by using the plus symbol for string concatenation. After assigning to s, we simply print s bracket k. Now that we've written the second line of our program, we know what the first line should be, just the second line in quotes to assign it as a string to env. So in total, our program looks like this. If you stare at this program for a while, you'll see that the string assigned to s is exactly the program's source code. So by running print s bracket k, we really do print the kth symbol of the program.
This procedure works in general. Suppose we wanted to write a program that takes some input w and computes a function f of s and w, where s is the program's own source code. We first write the code needed to compute f of s and w, assuming s has already been properly assigned. Then we use the exact same construction as before to get a program that looks like this. In this program, s is correctly assigned a string containing exactly the program's source code, and the remaining lines of code go on to compute f of s and w. We can make our lives even easier by shortening this bit of code with the statement s equals program code, where it's understood that this isn't an actual line of code, but rather some shorthand for the slightly more elaborate construction needed to actually store the program source code in a variable.
As mentioned earlier, the existence of self-referencing programs leads to provable limitations on the capabilities of computers. Here's an example. Is it possible to write a computer program that takes as input the source code of another program and correctly indicates whether or not that program will eventually halt upon running? For example, this program halts, whereas this program doesn't halt. For these examples, it's easy to determine whether or not they halt, but for complicated programs with millions of lines of code, determining whether or not they halt just from the source code can be extremely difficult. This famous problem is known as the halting problem, and it's well known that computers can't solve it. The proof is straightforward using self-reference.
Assume, for the sake of contradiction, that such a program H exists. H solves the halting problem, in the sense that whenever a string containing the code of another program is passed as input to H, H will correctly output either halts or doesn't halt. Now we'll construct a new program A that, when run, will plug its own source code into H and then do the opposite of whatever H said it would have done. More precisely, first, using the process described earlier, A obtains a copy of its own source code as a string. Then, A passes this string as input to H, and obtains a result, either halts or doesn't halt. If halt is obtained, A enters an infinite loop. If doesn't halt is obtained, A halts. You may be able to see what the contradiction is here. The problem is that H cannot correctly answer whether or not A halts. Remember that the source code of A is S, so if H outputs halt, then by analyzing the code of A, we can see that, in fact, A would not have halted. If H outputs doesn't halt, then we can see that A actually would have halted. Since no matter what, H is wrong when the source code of A is passed as input, H doesn't correctly solve the halting problem. It follows that no such program H can exist.
As another example, we'll show that it's impossible for a computer to solve the problem of determining whether or not a program is minimal. We say a program is minimal if no shorter program, shorter in terms of the number of symbols in the source code, has the same output. For instance, these two Python programs have the same output. They both print a string with 40 copies of the letter A. But this program has exactly 49 symbols, and this one has 45 symbols, counting new lines and spaces, meaning the first isn't minimal. We claim it's impossible to design a program that, given a string containing the source code of another program as input, always correctly determines whether or not that input program is minimal. Note how this problem is similar to the halting problem in the sense that we're proving it's impossible for a computer to determine particular aspects about program behavior straight from the source code. For the halting problem, that aspect of program behavior was whether or not the program halts. For this problem, that aspect is whether or not the program is minimal.
So let's see if we can prove this task is impossible using a similar strategy that we used to prove that the halting problem was impossible. Again, we'll try a proof by contradiction. We'll assume a program M exists such that, when provided with a string containing the code of another program, M correctly identifies whether or not that program is minimal. Like before, we'll try to construct a new program B that passes its own source code as input to M, and then contradicts whatever M says about it. In particular, B operates as follows. First, B obtains a copy of its own source code as a string, and then B passes that string as input to M to get a result. If M says B is minimal, we want B to not be minimal. But if M says B is not minimal, we want B to be minimal. The problem with this approach is that, in the case M says B is not minimal, there's no obvious way to add lines of code here to ensure that B is minimal. In fact, we can be sure B isn't minimal, because no matter what code we put here, all of this code can be replaced by the shorter statement, result equals not minimal, and then the shorter program will have the exact same output as B.
So, we'll need a different approach to get a contradiction. It's quite difficult to write down a program that's minimal and know it's minimal. So, instead of trying to construct a minimal program ourselves, we'll just ask M for one. In particular, we'll have B pass a bunch of random programs as input to M until M says one of them is minimal. Let's call that minimal program P. But how can B use P to force a contradiction in M? Well, since M claims P is minimal, we'd want B to do something that proves P isn't minimal. So, we need to find a program that outputs the same thing as P, but is shorter in length. Let's make that program B itself. We'll have B simulate P, so B outputs exactly what P outputs. And we'll ensure that B is shorter than P by only passing programs to M that are longer than B. With those ideas in mind, let's carefully write down exactly what B does. We need B to be passing the source code of random programs longer than itself as input to M. So, the first thing B should do is figure out its own length and store that in a variable n, like this. Then, to ensure B can actually find a minimal program P, we'll have B look through every single possible program of length longer than n, in some sort of order, passing each as input to M. We'll get back to exactly how that works in a minute. But, assuming B does eventually find a minimal program of length longer than n, it stores that program as P. Finally, B simulates P, outputting whatever P outputs. This gives our contradiction, since it means P actually isn't minimal, contrary to what M said.
The last detail we have to fill in is how B can loop through the set of all possible programs. One way B can do this is by first making a list of all the possible symbols that can appear in a program file. Then, B iterates through all files of length exactly n plus 1 by writing down the first symbol in the list n plus 1 times, and then changing one symbol at a time, perhaps using some sort of lexicographic ordering. For each file created, B checks to see if it's a syntactically correct program. If it is, B passes the file as input to M to check if it's a minimal program. If B exhausts all the length n plus 1 files without finding a minimal program, B moves on to files of length n plus 2, then n plus 3, and so on. Now, this may seem like a ridiculously slow and impractical algorithm, and it is. But we don't need the algorithm for practical purposes. We just need to show it exists and it works as intended. So how do we know B won't struggle indefinitely to find a minimal program? In other words, how do we know this conditional will eventually be satisfied, breaking the loop? The point is that the number of minimal programs is infinite, simply because the number of possible outputs is infinite, and each different output is associated with a different minimal program. Thus, there must be infinitely many minimal programs of length longer than n, since there are only finitely many programs of length at most n. And, since B eventually will encounter every program of length longer than n, B will certainly find a minimal program. This fills in the last details of our proof, so we're done. We got a contradiction, so our assumption that M exists is wrong. There is no program M that can correctly determine if an input program is minimal.
If you didn't follow that proof entirely, feel free to leave a question in the comment section. The logic behind self-reference is confusing, so you may need to take some time to rewatch the proof and think about it before it really clicks. At the heart of both of these proofs, the halting problem and the minimal program problem, lies the amusing truth that while computers are very powerful, it is their own power that sheds light on their weaknesses. We've left some additional puzzles on screen whose solutions involve self-reference to give you some practice with this new idea. Feel free to post your solutions to any of the puzzles in the comments section.
Lastly, we'd like to thank everyone for all the support we've received. As busy as we are with our lives beyond the channel, we keep coming back to make new videos because of the amazing and supportive community we're a part of. So don't forget to like and subscribe to show us you want to see more of our content. Well, I think that's all for today. Did we miss anything?